Hi guys, Luke here of SimBoxx, and this is our first ever Zoom interview. It's been a long time coming, a long time overdue. Delighted to be joined on our first ever Zoom interview by Dean Dodge. How are you doing, Dean?
Yeah, I'm very well, mate. You good?
Yeah, very well, thanks. So thanks for joining us today. You know, I know it's a very busy time. You've got the fight coming up February 19th. Big fight, yeah. The biggest fight of your career so far. First and foremost, how's things? How are you and how's camp?
I'm real well, mate. I'm really well. Camp's going tremendous, you know what I mean? We're getting some really good sparring and I'm ready to go now, to be honest, you know what I mean? 3 weeks today it is.
That's it, it's soon be here. But if we can, this is like I say, the first time I've had the pleasure of being joined by yourself on an interview. So just for our followers and our viewers, tell us a little bit about yourself. Where did it all start for Dean Dodge? What was the inspiration and the will to want to become a professional boxer?
Well, started off when I was about 11 years old. I was playing football and my coach told me to go down and for extra fitness, go down and join the boxing club. So it was literally just from there. I went down there, sparred my first sparring session on the first day I got there with a kid who was like, oh, he must have been like 20, 30 kilos heavier than me, and he hit me one time and I thought, Jesus Christ, you know what I mean? And ever since then, I just sort of just stuck at it. I think I had like around 45 amateur fights, boxed at elite level. And since then after that, turned pro.
So was there any kind of boxers that you followed when you was younger that kind of like inspirations and, you know, you kind of went to the gym, trained and then come home and watch those guys on TV? Who was your favourite fighter when you was younger?
Growing up, I didn't really watch too much boxing. I just loved the sport, but I remember, I think Amir Khan was coming through and then I think he just won the Olympics and he was pretty exciting to watch. I did like watching him. We used to stay up and watch him back when he was on the TV and stuff. Yeah. So yeah, probably Amir Khan, yeah.
I think obviously with that summer when he was at the Olympics in 2004 and he won that silver medal, you know, he really caught the imagination of the nation, and obviously that was the foundations to go on and become the superstar that he is, I guess. And I think we all got behind the story. It was a fantastic journey to follow.
Yeah. It's very good. You know what I mean? He was the only British Olympian to even go to the Olympics and come away to win that silver medal. It was amazing. After that, you know what I mean? Like later on, I started watching more boxers, but it was Amir Khan, really. I think Ricky Hatton was quite big back then as well. I was watching quite a bit of him, and he was exciting to watch as well.
Superb. So let's fast forward a few years. You finally, eventually turned pro. How did you find that transition from the amateur game into the pro ranks? And what's your memories of your pro debut? Like the nerves and the excitement and everything else.
So I turned pro in 2016 after having about 45 amateur fights. I always had a pro style. You know what I mean? I come forward. I used to rather like slipping in shots. I used to like going to the body. And to be honest, it took me like maybe one or two rounds to even warm up, you know what I mean? So I just knew when I was going to go pro, it just suited me down to a T. Turned pro in 2016, but I got denied my license because I failed a brain scan. Boxing board of control didn't give me a license. So I was battling that for a year. I met a girl on Tinder and she paid for the brain scan for me, and my dad happened to be a neurologist. I contested the brain scan.
Amazing.
Went back and forth with the board and that, and then they give me a license. And 3 years later, three, 4 years later, I've been a pro now. And then I think it's been 3 years I've been a pro now. And not once have I had a hiccup on the brain scan at all. So it's happy days. Yeah.
So we'll fast forward a few years. Obviously, we're coming up to the fight on February 19th. You've been in camp for that, of course. And with the whole COVID and the pandemic and the situation that's going on at the minute, you've, of course, been training for Christmas. Take us through how you've managed to keep yourself motivated and focused. You know, it'd be so easy to think that your fight might fall through and you know, you might not be as hard. How does that affect your mentality as you head into the fight?
I'm mentally quite bulletproof, you know what I mean? My mentality is bulletproof. Like, I've gone through a lot of things in life, let alone my boxing career. For this COVID situation, you know what I mean. It was annoying, but I knew that something would like would happen after from it, and that is, you know what I mean? I always stayed in the gym, even when the COVID first hit, when the gyms were shut, I had a bag up in the garden. I was training flat out through summer, going for massive bike rides, and just doing everything to keep my base level there.
Yeah, superb. So obviously looking through your social media, you can see these pictures there with the likes of Lee McGregor and Lee Wood, you know, some top class sparring. Those two have both got big fights coming up as well. So how has it been with the experience of sparring, you know, those kind of guys and getting that kind of experience?
It's been really good. I've sparred Lee McGregor before when he was with the McGuigans. So I know Lee. He's improved a lot since then as well. So going up there, sparring at the MTK Performance Center, being around like champions like Josh Taylor was in the gym,
yeah.
Billy Joe Saunders was in the gym, and training alongside Josh, training alongside Lee, training alongside Lee Wood is just unbelievable. You know what I mean? And the sparring is top notch. You know what I mean? You can't get anything better than that. Lee's fighting for a European title, and Lee Wood's fighting for a British title as well. So just perfect preparation.
Absolutely. So, you know, a bit of insider knowledge there with sparring them both. Do you believe that Lee goes on and win that European title? And likewise, do you think Lee Wood picks up the British title? Are you confident in those guys picking up the victories?
100%. Lee McGregor is looking razor and very strong for the weight. Lee Wood looking very good as well, very sharp. So, yeah, in my mind, both them boys are definitely going to come away with the titles.
Fantastic. Exciting times, you know, after the suspension of boxing in January, that we're getting into February and March and April, and we've got all these fights and all these shows coming up. So it's definitely exciting times.
Yeah, oh, mate, yeah, it's real good. You know what I mean? Like, a lot of the public, with January going on, thought that the fights weren't going to happen, but now they are coming ahead. So it's real exciting times.
Yeah, so you mentioned there that you was up at the MTK Performance and doing a lot of sparring there. And, of course, this fight that you've got coming up with Danny Carr is part of an MTK show. How did that link up come around? How did you get the opportunity to fight on what is, you know, a big platform in MTK? They're making giant strides in the game, and they're fast becoming one of the top names and one of the top labels in the sport of boxing.
I signed with a new manager. Someone a little bit local to me. My old manager, he was up north, so interest wasn't there for me to get involved for Seven Era. But I signed with someone down here, and he promised me that he'd get me an opportunity. And within signing with him, 2 weeks later, he got me the Seven Era title fight. So, you know what I mean? I was over the moon with that. And it happened to be that the Seven Era champion was an MTK fighter. The board sanctioned it, and here we are now. Lee's put it on.
Fantastic. So, of course, as you say there, and we've alluded to it a couple of times, that the area title is on the line, the first title of your career, I believe, and, you know, it's a great opportunity. I think it's an English title eliminator as well. So there's a lot riding on this. It's a big fight and a big platform, but there's opportunities that could arise from this as well, as I say, with the English title eliminator. There and thereabouts, and picking up the area title as well. So a lot of opportunities and a lot to keep you motivated.
Oh yeah, this is the massive opportunity. This is going to change my career. You know what I mean? Win this, it's just going to go from there to there to there. You know what I mean? So there's a little bit of pressure on myself, but I love the pressure. You know what I mean? I'm thriving off it. I'm thriving off the whole thing. I'm thriving on the fact that it's on a massive show. People are going to see me box for the first time. So a lot of people. A lot of boxing people don't know who I am, so it's good. I'm real going to just soak up the atmosphere and soak up the whole occasion.
We really do look forward to it. But looking at your opponent, Dan Carr, very similar in terms of records. I know he's a couple of years older than yourself, but he's 10-0, one draw, and yourself, you're 9-0 with one draw, so very similar in terms of records. But how much do you know of Dan Carr, and what do you feel like he does well, or likewise, what do you feel like you can take advantage of come fight night?
I've known Danny Carr, like we've known of him through the amateurs. He wasn't a bad amateur. I think he was the weight below me. I've seen a few of his fights. You know what I mean? I'm sort of like looking at everyone domestically, looking at them, you know what I mean? Spying on them, seeing what they're doing. And obviously he holds the belt. So I have looked into him a bit. He comes forward aggressive, but on Feb 19th, I think he ain't going to be able to handle me. I think I'm too big for him, too strong for him. I know I hit hard for the weight, so I just don't see Danny Carr coming away with that victory.
Fantastic. That leads into to my next question, which is, can we get an official prediction? If I put you on the spot, what's the prediction for fight night?
100%. I'm going there to knock Danny Carr out.
Fantastic. So it's been great looking at the build-up and what you've been up to in the lead-up to this fight. If we just move away from your fight for a second, as you say, we've got a lot of fights coming up throughout the early months of March, February, April, those kind of times. But the big fight that we're all looking to see this year, no doubt, is Anthony Joshua, Tyson Fury. I'm sure, as a fan of boxing yourself, you're looking forward to that fight. And I think you're like the rest of us, that we hope it is made in 2021.
Yeah, that's a huge fight, isn't it? It's a huge fight. I think it's going to go ahead in June. There's no actual confirmation there, but that is a massive fight. It's just a little bit annoying with the time, do you know what I mean? The whole COVID situation is very annoying, but hopefully it does go ahead in 2021, and it'd be a hell of a fight for sure.
If I was to put you on the spot again, is there a prediction there for that fight if it takes place?
Going on the recent activity and stuff, and who's looked the better, I'm going to have to go with man Tyson Fury, you know what I mean? Just his boxing ability. But who knows, you know what I mean? It's a 50-50 fight.
It's a great fight. As long as it happens, I think that's the main thing for sure.
100%, mate, 100%.
Yeah, Dean, so that's all my questions answered there. To finish, is anyone you'd like to give a shout-out to, any sponsors or anything like that you'd like to mention?
Yeah, definitely. I want to shout-out to my... I've got some full-time sponsors at the minute who've been helping me out. Penmo Scaffolding, Paragon Cleaning Services, Camelot Builders, and All Sport Insurance, and the T-shirt shop of Western Supermare. They've helped me out all year round. And for this fight coming up now, I've got three more companies to come on to help me out and sponsor me for this fight, which is Over the Moon, which is Sawdust, which is furniture and stuff and oak sort of woodwork. I've got Protein Planet, their supplement company, who've come on to support me, and I've got Blue Flame. What's the other one called? Yeah, Blue Flame Southwest. Yeah, he's a local friend of mine as well, and he's come on board and helped me out to sponsor me for this fight. So, yeah, big shout out to all them companies.
Yeah, fantastic. It's great to hear that you've got so many people supporting. You know, given that at this delicate time, you know, with no fans, no tickets to be sold, they play a vital role in helping up and coming boxers like yourself being able to train and prepare properly for such a big fight.
100%, mate. Without sponsors, you know what I mean. But a lot of boxers wouldn't be doing what they're doing because they're helping you pay a wage sort of thing. And without them sponsors, I'd be definitely in shit street. You know what I mean. So yeah, big shout out to them sponsors.
Absolutely. Well, thanks for your time today, Dean. You know, the best of luck for February 19th. We'll all be tuning in. Wish you the best of luck for that fight, and we'll catch up again in the future.
Thank you, mate. And the new.
You heard it here first. Cheers, Dean.
Top man.